I am supposed to talk about the future of how we live, and I will do it through the medium of architecture. Architecture is an unbelievably slow art. The least architecture effort takes 10 years. So it is very bad art to capture the zeitgeist. We are simply too slow for the zeitgeist, and particularly in this century. Our slowness has been kind of really a huge disadvantage. But in the meantime, all our metaphors and all the terms we use, all our words, have been kind of taken over by other domains. And particularly Silicon Valley has been kind of very good to use any one of these in terms of trying to make sense of their overall effort. Basically, because we are so slow, an architect today has to be at the same time a kind of sociologist and kind of maybe an anthropologist. And independent of his kind of work, try to understand how the world works. And basically, I've been able to do that as a teacher in Harvard, where, for instance, we looked at China before China was kind of really exploding, and where we discovered that in China, the condition of the city is changing radically. You see it here. This is the major metropolitan center of Shenzhen. And 400 meters away, there are rice fields. So the solidity of a city kind of doesn't exist in China anymore. Cities are provisional and temporary. We had to kind of understand the effect of the market economy in burdening kind of every single citizen in the world with a number of square meters that they have to kind of support and sustain. Fortunately, there's a lot of inequality in those kind of burdens. And we had to understand also how poverty kind of affects cities. And this is a picture of Lagos, supposedly the most dysfunctional kind of entity in the world. But if you look carefully, you see kind of concentrations of color, and then you kind of realize that this is not simply a dump, but a kind of recycling center. And you see in this picture, which is a picture of a market, but it also happens to be the picture of a railroad and a train that runs here maybe twice a day. And that obviously because of the market is running so unbelievably slowly that the pace of the train is compatible with selling of the market people to the passengers in the train. So as an architect, you have to be kind of deeply aware that in every dysfunction, there is the potential of new functionalities and new ways of working. 2 years ago, I kind of worked on an interpretation or a look, a hardcore look at how each of the elements of architecture, the door, the window, the ceiling, the floor, had been changing kind of under the onslaught, you could say, of the digital world, and discovered that actually no single element was kind of really the same, that basically we had thermostats that could learn, that could anticipate, and that kind of became interactive, so that basically you are not entirely in control of the kind of temperature of your own house. We learned that floors can be equipped with sensors that kind of record every kind of single movement. And we felt, discovered that there were toilets today that respond to every event and analyze it kind of very, very carefully. So what we then discovered is that there is some degree of enthusiasm for turning the entire city into a kind of similar device-ridden environment. And so that we architects were still thinking that we were dealing with the classical elements of architecture, but that those elements, that classical dimension, is at this point completely transforming in something which we still have to understand and still particularly have to understand for the consequences of this sensor society are going to be, and also what the consequences on the city are. Anyway, what we've been kind of recently looking for, because everyone is kind of obsessed with the city, and the statistic that more than half of mankind now lives in the city is a kind of pretext for even more attention to the city. We started to look at the countryside and kind of simply were wondering, okay, everyone is living in the city, what happened to the countryside and what is the condition of the countryside today? Cities occupy 2% of the earth, and the countryside 98%. So all of this territory is kind of, in a weird way, actually not really paid attention to as much as I think it deserves. Nevertheless, there is a kind of huge nostalgia for the city. This is a kind of average contemporary kind of bookstore. All these magazines are in some ways kind of connected to the countryside. And that is true in America, in Europe, and in Asia. So we're ignoring the countryside, but we're at the same time still conceptually obsessed with it. What did we discover about the countryside? One very important thing is that the digital is not only working, of course, in the city, but it is also marrying almost the most traditional elements of the countryside, the tractor. The tractor has become kind of really a digital office in many different ways. And the kind of farmer is somebody with an elaborate screen on which the progress and the kind of future of every kind of single square inch or square millimeter of the plot is being carefully plotted and executed again by kind of more or less kind of mechanized and semi-robotized tractors, and then kind of followed by digital devices and even by drones. So we are living now in a kind of situation where although the earth is real, and although, of course, what grows on the earth is real, most of the way it is kind of planned and managed is in the hands of digital technologies. Now, what else is happening in the countryside? And this is kind of really for me the most important thing in terms of where I think we will live and work, and what are the crucial commissions or the crucial kind of breakthroughs that are necessary in architecture, or for what situation architecture should really prepare itself. And one of the, for me, kind of most stunning kind of surprises was the enormous scale that collectively all the server farms, all the fulfillment centers, all the distribution centers, basically the incredible scale of the physical infrastructure that is necessary to implement the supposedly ethereal dimension of internet. And basically, it is very clear that that physical infrastructure is too big for the city, and that therefore it has to go into the countryside. Now, I'm kind of looking in particular here, or kind of presenting what I think is really a picture or a zoom on what the future could be and what the future perhaps needs to be. Silicon Valley is, of course, in California. On the other side of the border with Nevada, there's Reno. And outside Reno, there's a kind of enormous industrial center called Tahoe Reno, which is in itself as big as Singapore and a lot bigger than kind of Reno itself. And in this territory, actually, it looks kind of very desert-like here, but it is lush and green, there is an enormous assembly and rapidly expanding assembly of enormous infrastructures kind of for the digital age. Almost all of them, or practically all of them, contain in boxes. You see kind of one of them here, you see the kind of scale of those apparatuses, and kind of perhaps the most well-known so far is the Gigafactory of Tesla, a kind of battery factory that will be kind of have a roof of only solar connectors. Here you see the kind of reality, kind of pretty enormous. Here you see it in its current condition, and you see that there is kind of really a true race toward the kind of biggest single building that can be imagined. And here we already have buildings that are a mile, and some of them are plotted to be 2 miles long. Now, what does this mean for architecture? I think the irony is that perhaps for architecture this could mean kind of an interesting new dimension. Most of these buildings are highly automated and highly kind of robotized. So that means that architecture perhaps does not have to think too much about the human inhabitant. Maybe architecture is no longer condemned to beige, as we are kind of, if you look around us here, but can be a lot more harsh and a lot more open in terms of choosing its effect, as you see here already kind of emerging. The human habitation of these kind of instances or buildings is quite paradoxical, because maybe we are still necessary to make them run, but at the same time, we are treated with suspicion. We cannot kind of easily come from one part into another. And basically, the only kind of humanistic kind of remnant is the soft environment of a kind of quasi Cambodian or Asian kind of environment. And so what is happening, I think, is architecture on the one hand, a kind of really harsh and stark futuristic and perhaps not entirely humanistic component, and the kind of humanistic sense being contracted in kind of small rooms. And this can, in certain buildings, be even more extreme, where, for instance, the light spectrum is eliminated and where only kind of one section of the light which promotes the purpose of the building is kind of left to perform. And I would say that this kind of architecture has never happened before, and that it's kind of the direct outcome of our current kind of organizations, technologies, and kind of values. And as you see, it's kind of single person inhabiting a territory larger than kind of four soccer fields. So what do we create in these buildings in terms of spaces? And what kind of interaction do we promote in these buildings? And do we, for instance, anticipate in these buildings some kind of coexistence and maybe in the end some kind of relationship between robots and human beings? Last week I went kind of to look at this kind of area in person. Here you see the intellectual and here the salesperson, the owner of this kind of truly amazingly beautiful site, and here we're looking at it. You cannot imagine a more touchingly, seemingly virginal territory, on which, of course, you see the kind of signs of flattening, the kind of flattening that is necessary for our contemporary conditions. And you see the kind of architecture that is emerging there. This is the Tesla factory, what is there. And it becomes even more impressive if you consider that the kind of section which is there is only this part of the kind of eventual scale it will have. And so there, if you kind of think of these environments, and if you think perhaps that simply spoiling them kind of with inert boxes and with the typical gestures that already have in other parts of the world kind of shown that they're not particularly animating or not particularly kind of sensitive or not particularly satisfying to for both the world and its inhabitants, you may begin to kind of consider that maybe what could be generated here or in the process of being generated is a kind of new contemporary sublime. The sublime is produced by an overwhelming sense of awe or high emotion through being vast or grand. And of course, the sublime has been a kind of critical component of Western kind of values and of Western aesthetics, and in a certain way being considered the highest expression of them. And what I find very, very interesting is that these boxes in their abstraction actually already come close to it, and that it seems as if with a relatively modest extra effort, you could generate more of it, or you could kind of create a kind of shift where from a kind of inadvertent sublime, it turns into a deliberate sublime. This is a project by Ledoux, a large pyramid. And so you could imagine kind of a pyramid of server farm in the form of a pyramid also in this landscape. You could also imagine, as architects have done kind of in the 60s, kind of sublime and abstract forms simply independently inhabiting landscape and creating not an involuntary relationship between them, but really a deliberate aesthetic that is based on the contrast between nature and these highly abstract forms, as you can see in these two entities. So what I think is, and what you also see is if this is the kind of landscape, the landscape of boxes, you can also see that kind of in relatively modest steps, you could, for instance, create a shape that immediately becomes kind of much more touching and much more impressive, and at least emanates a value other than pragmatism and practicality in their most extreme and basic form. So what I'm preparing for as an architect, and what I think architecture should be prepared for, is perhaps to begin to think about these kind of conditions. You cannot call it a city anymore because the scale is the scale of a city, but certainly the amount of people inhabiting them will be a lot smaller. And so therefore the spaces between them, you cannot call them public space. They are inhabited by trucks, self-driving cars, and some buses that deposit the workers, but nevertheless, they will exist. They will exist in greater and greater numbers. They will define the countryside, and kind of somehow, I feel that this interaction, this curious interaction between automation, robotization, and workforce, contemporary workforce in the landscape, is a really crucial thing to think about. Thank you very much.